you know, a bit like the rest of us that are up here presenting. This is the team from last year. Jack squeezed in apparently he was voted the second best presentation that year. I can't remember who was the first, so. And this is Jack picking up the David Tickish Award, and his dad picking up the Young Hygienist. Thanks.
Fantastic, thank you, Craig.
I've definitely got to check out flame ionisation detectors. I don't remember seeing a flame, but they look good.
Yeah, Alex has got to do the shelter to sell the guns as well. So.
Yeah. That's great, fantastic. Unfortunately for you guys now, it's me up next. So, we're filling the gap. So this is a presentation I did in Australia, so I think there's only probably two or three people in this room that have seen it already, so I'm hoping it will be informative.
Can I just make a point that obviously booing will also get picked up? for the wrong reason, okay, so.
Yes, it's good for low frequencies as well. Alright, so yeah, Martin, that's great. I'm just going to give you a bit of a personal story, really, about how I think, as hygienists, we need, and Karen mentioned, she just walked in the room, Karen mentioned this morning about using the different skills, so technical skills, the soft skills, the professional skills, really. So the journey that I was on as a young scientist, really kind of wanted to know where I wanted to be in life, where was I going to go, what was I going to do. And I was always a scientist, and then I came across this profession. And it's part of the job description, also it's part of the job description of being an occupational hygienist. And I quickly found out from a very, very short time at university that this was the profession that I really wanted to do. And so I did it. So I found the right ladders, I found the right paths, met some great people, and I was, there you go, with me, no beard, my little VP student days. So living the dream, and I was lucky enough to do that, and then I landed in the steel industry. So people talk about good industries. The steel industry is a fantastic proving ground to learn your skills as an occupational hygienist, because it's dirty, and that's just not the people. But I met people as part of that in the industry and in the profession. So my first conference was 11 years ago, and from then I've met people, and they've inspired me, and they've taught me the technical skills that I need to be the technical hygienist. But in my time at the steel industry, I wanted to do more than just go out and measure everything. I wanted to make a change. I wanted to change things at the top so that we wouldn't just have to keep doing things at the bottom. But I quickly realised that I couldn't just do that by going out and putting my pump on somebody and going out and measuring the noise. I needed other skills to help me make that change. So these are some called soft skills, metacompetencies, and all the other stuff. So these skills were something that I knew I needed to acquire. So this is me at the weekend, my previous filming camera. So I needed that other string to my bow. I needed to go out and get the other things that I needed to make me a better professional in order to make me be able to do the work that I really wanted to do. I needed to increase my knowledge in those processes and learn those new techniques so that I could go to the senior managers of organisations and actually be able to make positive change in their behaviour and their thinking. One of the other things I did was I threw myself into the profession. So this is just my little mosaic of some of my achievements and experiences, and this has allowed me to meet amazing people, some of them are in this room right now, and just have that direction and that kind of enforcement to keep pushing me to go further. So it's something that you can't do by yourself, you've got to do it with other people. So I really, really encourage people to throw themselves into the profession and really help you build on that. I now find myself at Rolls-Royce with a pretty senior job, which is scary but very exciting. I wouldn't have been able to have got this job without the fantastic technical skills that I learned along the way, but also some of the other skills that I've been taught as part of our process as well. But it's not something that I say, right, I'm done now, I don't have to learn anymore. It's a continuous thing, it's for all of us, it's a cycle. So we're always learning, we should always revisit that, and we should always go back to it and look at other ways to make us better professionals. This is my left and right side of the brain. I think it's really important to use both. So we are scientists, but we can use creativity to sell our results, to sell what we really want to get across. And so we can all become the super IHs that I said in San Antonio once. So we can all be those superheroes that Amanda's talked about before, because we can use the skills that we can learn over time in our professions and in our careers, really. So be a sponge. That's another thing, really. Absorb the information that you find yourselves in. If that's in this week at a conference, talking with people at work, talking with people, fellow professionals at regional meetings and things like that. Build on the, so you've got the same picture as well, man. It's amazing, isn't it? But you build on those technical skills, which also allows you to work on those soft skills. So they go in tandem with each other. You can't do one without the other. And it's really important to do that. Thinking outside the box, someone else already said that as well. We should not be afraid of changing things up and doing things a little bit differently. Just because so-and-so said that's the way we do it doesn't mean that that's the way we have to do it in the future. If we think outside the box, we can change people's behaviours, we can change the way people speak. So, I think we need both. We need technical skills, we need those soft skills in order for us to be great professionals. And, just a little quote at the bottom as well. So, culture is strategy for breakfast. So, that's a nice one to finish. Thank you very much. So she was nominated by her peers 2 weeks ago. Yeah, maybe a week ago, while in Iraq. I know we're going to get a good presentation.
We'll see. So thanks a lot, anyway. Okay. Right, so 20 years ago, I started as an asbestos analyst. And never in my wildest dreams did I think in 2008 I'd end up living in the Middle East or working in the Middle East. Whoa, where did that come from? It came from Shell Health, who rang me and said, would you fancy moving to Qatar for a new job? Yeah, why not? Sounds like a good idea. I never thought that the impact it would have on me. They just told me in the interview one thing, you need to do something about your living conditions. My husband, who he now is, well, at last she's going to marry me. So we changed a day on our holiday, we got married in Qatar, in the Seychelles. And moved to the Middle East. Never thought about the impact that would have on us. So the Middle East. What's the average day in the Middle East? My hottest, 56 degrees. My coldest, hailstones the size of marbles. The dustiest, about here. The windiest, 2 tornadoes in one day. So what do? I take everything in my rucksack, everything that the weather can throw at me. Be flexible. You can always come back tomorrow when conditions become intolerable, when there's a rainstorm. Okay, the Middle East. What's important to them? They always say, socialize first, business later. So I've drunk an awful lot of aromatic coffee and eaten a lot of mezze meals. But those relationships you build are so important. Take 5 minutes out at the start of each day or every meeting to build that relationship. When you then need to ask some support for a control measure, or you need some help, they're behind you. Their loyalty's always there. Okay, Arabic. As a Westerner, it's impossible. I can't read it, I can't understand it. Even a name is so difficult to understand. Lots of things, Abdul Muhammad Aziz. So what do? I learn digits. I can write down their names just by their staff number. Okay, and last resort, I take my IH trainee with me who's got a really good grasp of English, and that's my important working part. Okay, it's remote locations. There's lots of other things, greenfield sites, from the tiny, tiny little things to the great big animals. You get used to it. So, 3 rules. Number one, don't approach and don't touch. There's some pretty nasty ones out there. Rule number 2, always turn your boots upside down and shake them hard. Scorpions like boots. And rule number three, put your sandwiches in your lunchbox, otherwise you'll be the Pied Piper of Hamelin with the dogs. Okay, gender. If you're not married to the person, to a man or a woman, you're not allowed to have any physical interaction. Okay, that includes just shaking hands. So what do? We give people the option. We talk to them. We find a way to, to fit a sampling device on somebody. Okay, facial hair, that's a good one. You've got to trim your moustache, but you've got to leave your beard the length of a fist. If you leave some darkness, it's okay, but if you take away all the colour, you'll be enough woman. So, again, there's always a way around it. An electric shaver leaves enough darkness, a blade's no good. Okay, but sometimes still I have to take it a bit further and give them a loose-fitting RPE. It's the only way sometimes. All right, timekeeping. Arabic timekeeping. It's definitely not like Western timekeeping. There's always an excuse why somebody didn't turn up, why they were late, why a meeting's cut short, but it doesn't mean it's not important. Okay, so the big thing is don't get frustrated, don't get annoyed, just build it into your schedule. Add the extra half an hour or the extra day that it takes you. There's always tomorrow. Don't worry about it. Okay, another real bugbear, import and export bureaucracy. How many times have I got a pile of chemicals or some Draker tubes have arrived? Guess what? They've already expired. Or I take some samples and I can't get them out. Ruined samples. So you have to think what you're going to do. Use direct reading. Buy your calibration gases and your accessories at the time of ordering your equipment. Okay, and really plan, plan, plan. So, I'm going to leave you with a couple of things to think about in a minute. Ooh, I'm lost now. All right, build relationships. Important. Really spend your time. That's strange. I was going to leave you with four things, sorry. And say, don't stress if you can't change it. And enjoy it. That's the important thing, enjoy it.
Flexible and open we need to be as professionals who work with very vast different groups of people, so that's really interesting insight. Alright, so next up we've got Perita. So Perita's come all the way from what moment?
Hi! So, today I'm going to talk to you about a bit of a personal journey I've been going through in the last 6 months. So a little bit about me. I've been working in occupational hygiene for 10 years in steel industry as well, and I'm married with two children, who are 2 and 4 as well. So, manufacturing in the world. This is a common issue within a lot of the countries that we've come from. Manufacturing is significantly decreasing the amount of people that are employed in it. Specifically, I was working in steel. So you can see by the next slide that steel in Australia, in the UK, is taking a bit of the same journey. Things are slowing down, industry is impacting on that, so the car industry is closing up completely next year in Australia for good. So as a professional, where do I go to? I want to work for a large and diverse organisation. Personally, and I have my personal choices for this, I don't want to work in consultancy, and I don't purely want to be an occupational hygiene model either, because I want to have a very broad focus on employee health. Personally, I have 2 young children, so work-life balance is very important. I want to be home, I want to have dinner with them. Melbourne's a large city, if you've never been there. I live an hour from the city. It can take a long time to travel from one part to the other part, and I want to work as part of a team. So which industry to look at? You can see here that healthcare is at the top of the graph. So I've looked at what options are there for me to work in healthcare. And I was very lucky at the time when I was looking for a job. There was a position in a local hospital network for a health and safety business partner. So this is an organisation that employs 16,000 people with over 40 sites. It's a large organisation. Good team and no hygiene expertise. Now, in Australia, hospitals don't generally employ hygienists. And I suspect that's probably the case in a number of places as well. However, there is a large range of occupational hygiene hazards, and I'm going to go through a few of the things that I've seen in the last 5 months. Manual handling and ergonomics are obviously still a large issue. So chemicals, I've got some photos here. There is no room in hospitals, by the way, so you've got equipment in hallways, you've got equipment stuck in little rooms, we've got endoscopy, we've got large pathology labs. We've obviously still got your typical kind of chemicals that you see, so we have engineering departments who do welding. Oxygen bottles, they are everywhere and very rarely restrained. So, and we also have cleaners, so there's a large amount of chemicals as well. Confined spaces, it's like any organisation, there's confined spaces, and you have other things to add to that, including anaesthetic acid, which seem to be everywhere as well. So some of the other issues that we have outside of chemicals are noise. So if you've been to hospital, you realise that you get some lovely food there, so there's large production kitchens there with large dishwashers. Vibration, I was an